I think the average person needs to be aware of what is going on, not just here in Canada, because of course, you know, we are dealing with our own legacies of a process of cultural genocide. So that's one, you know, at home, to know our own history, our own roles as members of settler societies in this kind of ongoing set of legacies, how we can recognize our own privileged circumstances, how we can maybe try to empower those who are not in that kind of situation. Internationally, a part of it is simply just staying informed. And this is in a previous year, I would have said that's a relatively easy thing to do. Just read a lot of the news, watch a lot of TV, news programs and so on, read widely. But in an era of so-called fake news, of a kind of, you know, the use and abuse of social media to sow disinformation, this is actually a hard thing now for ordinary people to do. And so you still need to be well informed, but you have to be really discriminating about what kind of sources you use to stay informed. I think those good sources are still out there, the kind of, you know, standard, a long time media outlets with really good journalists, really good journalism programs, really well trained kind of public academics who are able to kind of tell us what is happening in certain parts of the world to which we don't have ready access. That kind of obligation as a kind of informed citizenry internationally and domestically, I think, is really key. So that's the first part of it. The second part is to just get out there and make sure that your concerns are known to officials who can do something about it. Even in an era of globalization, states and their capacity are really the actors, the main actors, that can bring an end to or stop or respond in some way to mass atrocities, right? So if something is going on domestically or internationally that needs to be attended to, it really is the Canadian government, the Canadian federal government, that needs to know. We all have our own MPs. Contact them. Contact the Minister of Defense, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Prime Minister's office. These are all people who are critical to have on board for some kind of policy. This is probably going to have to be a repeat effort to get their attention. It's going to be an effort in which citizens need to band together with other like-minded citizens, with NGOs, with concerned citizen groups domestically and internationally to make that case. The other thing I think is just how we act in our own day-to-day lives. I'm not saying that we're going to all experience genocide at some point in our own lives, but we lead by a kind of moral example. So how you treat other people, how you treat people who are different from you, I think is also critical, right? It creates a kind of level of civility, of respect, beyond just tolerance. Tolerance just means you can put up with somebody different from you. It has to be much more than that. A kind of conscious and genuine effort at inclusion and respect. And the more we can do that, the more you build, I think, a kind of resilience. So if we can do that here in Canada, that can spread elsewhere, I think ultimately that is the thing that makes genocide hard for perpetrators to do. If there is a population of people who will not act as bystanders, who will not abandon a targeted group, that's the ultimate prevention right there.